morning, everyone. This is Diane Fodell. Thanks for joining our Cognitive Systems Institute Group Speaker Series call. And today I am happy to introduce our presenter from New York University. Regina Joseph is the founder of Sibylink, an international consultancy based in The Hague and New York, devoted to providing strategic foresight on global issues through futures forecasting, scenario building, training courseware, and digital solutions development. Regina is also a member of the faculty at New York University's Center for Global Affairs. At NYU, she teaches courses on technology, among them, and she is the first to teach cognitive computing to non-computer scientists, tasking them to use IBM's Watson supercomputer to develop applications around matters of geopolitics and security. She's worked as a senior research fellow, future security foresight, and at a think tank based in The Hague. More credentials, which I will post in the chat. We're lucky to have Regina today as a speaker, and she's going to talk to us about cognitive computing, a future pathway for global affairs. And can you see the slides okay, Regina?
Yep, I can see them.
All right. Thanks, Regina. I'll turn it over to you.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Good morning. Thank you all so much for taking the time out to listen to this presentation. I'm going to keep it fairly brief because I'm sure you'll have some questions. So I figured that better for me to run through these slides relatively quickly so that it can engender a good discussion, and then I suppose we can go back and forth if people want to go back and look at any of the data in the charts in the presentation. So let's click forward to the next slide. So what we're looking at when we talk about global affairs is a fairly general rubric within the umbrella of the term of global affairs. You might use the term international relations. You might use the term political science. You might use the term security studies or strategic security studies or strategic foresight studies. I'm sort of value neutral on all of that. Global affairs is a reasonably good catch-all. I myself specialize in strategic foresight, so I'm looking at using quantitative forecasting techniques, qualitative techniques like scenario building in helping to drive analyses, structured technical analyses of geopolitical matters. And why I think this is particularly important, has relevance to people in the cognitive community, is because of the issues that we are facing in the arena of global affairs right now. There are two very, very major challenges to pedagogy and reach. For global affairs to really take hold. And this is a somewhat paradoxical situation because at most universities in the United States, the number of programs or initiatives within institutes that are devoted to international relations or global affairs or international studies, these programs are actually proliferating, right? So there's a greater attraction amongst the millennial generation and younger generations to pursue careers in the humanitarian world, in international NGOs. So the proliferation of these programs actually is done as an economic effect to attract the level of that student interest. However, there are a couple of fairly major challenges to this increase or proliferation of programs. The first being money. We see a very serious decline in the actual money committed to programs that fund research. And when I say programs, I mean of the kind Title VI funding, Title VIII funding, all of that funding that was developed by the federal government to permit advanced studies in linguistics, that permit students to travel abroad so that they can receive immersive educations in the cultural or the political, diplomatic, what have you, over those structures in foreign countries. The type of funding that was created back in the 1950s to enable people who wanted to work in the future for the State Department, all of this funding has been drastically cut in the last 2 years. The second challenge, and if you can click forward, thank you. The second challenge, of course, is demography, right? The youth bulge of the millennial generation is such that over the next 5 years, we're going to be experiencing some quite challenging environments because of the speed at which these younger people are coming into not only university teaching environments, but also into the workforce. And I'll go into a little bit of detail on that in the next slide. So if you click forward, what I put forth as a potential solution is that embedding cognitive computing training is an integral component of teaching international studies, that this could be a possible resolution or innovative pathway to confront challenges that we're experiencing right now in the field of political science. If we can click forward to the next slide. And, you know, part of how to understand this is forces us to stretch back to the 20th century, 1950s. In 1957, when Russia launched Sputnik, the fear and panic that it set off in the U.S. government about potential dominance by Russia in the fields of science and scientific exploration, particularly space exploration, that fear and panic was so extreme that pushed the U.S. government to, in 1958, create what is currently known as Title VIII funding. The National Defense Education Act was developed specifically as one facet, or Title VIII funding was one facet of the 1958 National Defense Education Act, the inception of which was a direct response to Russia's launch of the Sputnik satellite in 1957. Those Cold War fears over Russia's possible dominance in technical fields at the time, you know, forced the U.S. government to act decisively in building a knowledge culture that was equipped to contend with that particular national complexity. But Title VIII's cuts in the last 2 years have been so extensive, in some cases up to 60% to 80% of funding and cuts in linguistic programs, travel abroad programs to students, to scholars who want to immerse themselves more deeply in that information. Those cuts have been quite extensive, and the true irony of these cuts to Title VIII funding is that most of these cuts occurred just months prior to Russia's launch of a new type of Sputnik in 2014. If you click forward I don't know how many people in the audience are familiar with this, but Sputnik is actually a Kremlin-directed multimedia news service that replaced Russia's RIA Novosti news service, and it is conceived as an aggressive propaganda counterweight to Western news media. So the irony is that just as a new Cold War is heating up between Russia and the U.S., the education pathway that served U.S. strategic interests best in the 20th century are being almost completely eroded in the 21st. If you can click through to the next slide. And then let's take a look at that with regards to the nature of the demographic challenges that we face. As you can see, in the next 5 years, by 2020, the expectation both at the U.S. level as well as the global level is that we're going to be seeing the millennial demographic cohort represent about 50% of the workforce. And that carries with it some very serious consequences, because the technology that has defined millennial lives also shapes the challenges that they face. If you can click through to the next section. If you look at the difference between how millennials perceive their skills and how employers perceive them, you can see that there are a lot of big disparities, and those disparities are going to have effects. So to overcome the friction in the transition, which is going to be a very rapid one, this transition to decision-making power, organizations and educational institutions have no choice but to enable millennials to rise above their own technology-mediated perspectives, perceptions of their skills, and to hone their analytical ability in preparation of the quantified world they're going to face. Next slide, please. And as I'm sure everybody on this call is well familiar with, now that we are officially in a zettabyte age, those challenges, the reality of that 21st century landscape, are quite serious indeed. And you can just click through. These are just a numerical assessment of the nature of the four V's of the information era that we face, the volume, the sheer volume of what people are going to contend with, especially young people, the velocity at which it's coming at them, the variety, the various different types of information formats that they will need to confront. And also there's the veracity factor, especially when you, if we're talking about global studies, international affairs, international relations, the intensity of propaganda in a technological environment like the internet, where being able to track veracity becomes exponentially more difficult, this is also a really major challenge confronting people, especially millennials, as they prepare to transition into the workforce, into higher education, where they are getting prepped to have their hands on the levers of power. So we have to start thinking now about how to deal with that. Next slide, please. So, you know, if we look at it from the challenges at the pedagogical level, if you can click forward, please, and there, I know Diane is quite familiar with this. I'm sure many other people are familiar with this. If you could just click backwards just to the first one, you know, what we are facing in the educational environment is that, you know, in the paradox that we face is that technology and education are perceived as being enablers of better responses to the kinds of challenges that we face. But what we're seeing in the 21st century is that technology and education, paradoxically, are also barriers to achieving that optimal workforce, right? The speed of society's digital transformation has altered and fragmented the depth of knowledge of people under the age of 35. And that's due to changes in news media, news consumption habits, the quality of news being used, and also, more importantly, the fact that current higher education diploma programs are oriented around establishing deep expertise in a narrow area. That's the foundation of the PhD. This combination is suboptimal for handling a landscape that's continuously morphing, that's getting more complex. The four V's of information make it more complex. Social science research studies repeatedly show that cultivating, and if you can click through to the next slide, the so-called T-shaped individual as a necessity to ensure a smoother integration of that millennial workforce into managerial responsibility in an uncertain world. You know, and if you can click through once again, this idea of taking not just the niched columnar expertise, that narrowed expertise, which is the foundation of our current educational or pedagogical teaching, but also encouraging people to broaden their boundary-crossing competencies, right? They should be good generalists as much as they are a good niched experts in a particular field. But I think that we have to kind of extend that forward beyond just the T-shape into, next click please, into not just the T-shaped idea, but even a pie-shaped idea, that expertise in one particular niched area is not sufficient. Two is better, but I would put forth that beyond the pie-shaped, and if you could click forward, that actually the cone-shaped is even a more ideal structure, that you want to cultivate a future generation of people who have niched expertise across a broad array of subjects, in addition to that broad generalist knowledge that they also harbor. Students are losing that in the technological age, right? The transformation of our news consumption, the transformation of our exposure to information is making that very difficult. And so we need to start from the premise that we're looking for comb-shaped individuals. We're looking for people who have good, strong, niched expertise as well as they do have a broad generalist understanding. Next slide, please. And, you know, if we look at some of the studies that have been done recently, these are from the Pew Research Center, you can see the extent of the the nature of what we face. If we accept that familiarity, and here we're talking about global affairs, of course, international relations, political science, the bedrock of that type of pedagogy is in exposure to news information, being on top of what's going on in foreign countries. And it's not just news information, it's being able to understand what a map is. It's being able to look at a photograph and develop critical reasoning about what you see in that photograph. The problem is that if you take a look and see on a comparative level how millennials are absorbing political information, information about governance, where their interests lie, it's quite markedly different from that of previous demographic cohorts. And this should be a major cause for concern, especially when you are looking at, if you look at the graph on the far right corner, millennials are less aware of news sources than older demographic cohorts. And if you look at the quality of information that they're absorbing, there are major differences there. And that has a knock-on effect as to how well you can build a pathway for these kinds of students in the field of global affairs. So if you click through to the next slide, please. So, you know, how do we move beyond this, right? So one of the things, we use disruption as a metaphor. That's the current metaphor du jour in Silicon Valley. I to some degree, I think that's a bit of old wine in new bottles. I mean, back in the dot-com era of the late 1990s, early 2000s, you know, back then, what is disruption today back then was paradigm changing, right? So just different buzzwords, but same essential meaning. But what we're looking for here are technologies that really do have the potential to create seismic shifts. And so IARPA, which some of you may, on this call might be familiar with, IARPA, which is the R&D branch of the U.S. government, IARPA standing for the Intelligence Advanced Research Projects Activity, they are one of the most interesting research funding organizations within the federal government that are devoted to looking for ways to improve our national intelligence and how that benefits national security. IARPA has engaged, if you could click through to the next image, please. IARPA has spent a considerable amount of money on research looking at how to develop the kinds of disruptive technologies that can help enable or can confront or mitigate some of these challenges that we're facing with younger demographic groups like millennials. Phil Tetlock, Barb Mellers were funded by IARPA there was a program called the ACE program, and that program was dedicated to developing forecasting tournaments to identify who are the most accurate geopolitical forecasters. Phil Tetlock's work has been very focused on this. A 2006 book that was released called Expert Political Judgment, that book was central in identifying the difference between foxes and hedgehogs. A fox, which is a slightly analogous way of referring to T-shaped individuals, the fox being the creature that knows a little bit about a lot of things. The hedgehog is the creature that is knows everything about one thing. What Phil Tetlock's research and IARPA's research has shown is that experts are actually quite bad at geopolitical forecasting, geopolitical analysis when clinically evaluated. The people who actually are very good and even shockingly good exceeded the expectations of people within government and beyond is that certain types of generalists that have a mix of both the broad general understanding as well as niched expertise, these are the people that have the best level of understanding of geopolitical affairs. If you could click through. The work of Phil Tetlock and Barb Mellers for IARPA was collectively known as the Good Judgment Project, and if you can click forward to the next. Judgment Project did was essentially develop forecasting tournaments, and these are just pure tests of accuracy. They're designed to get people to give percentage probabilities on events, geopolitical events that they think are going to happen. Now, this can serve as a fairly cost-effective vehicle to engage millennials because it forces participants in forecasting tournaments to develop optimal use of open source information. They have to figure out how to go out and seek new sources of news and maps and things like that so they can improve the depth of their knowledge. I would also argue, please, that, you know, especially when we're dealing with the potential that cognitive computing presents, and right now I'm engaged in teaching this course utilizing Watson, that students are getting the opportunity to build applications on, using Watson. These applications are focused around matters of geopolitics, international relations. What these students are learning is not only in building the corpus, they have to understand how to research smarter. And that is something that really gives them a practical platform for them to harness not only skills, but expand those skills. And not only that, by not only going through the process of corpus and ingesting that corpus, getting them to test their Q&A pairs, and then actually develop an application, that requires an entrepreneurial mindset. And it's that level of entrepreneurialism that is also lacking in the pedagogical arena. Now, you can find that if you're specifically in an MBA program, for example. But it's much, much harder to find that in the social science or humanities-based types of programs that are frequently involved with, say, political science or international relations. You know, these students are going to be turned loose into a gig economy, and the gig economy does not favor the poorly informed. So we need to find these kinds of platforms, and I think, you know, Cognitive offers a really terrific a potential environment to engage these students, teach them the kinds of skill sets that they're going to need if they're going to be able to navigate the 21st century successfully. And I think help them sort of forge the next iteration of how 21st century computing evolves. And so with that, I think, you know, that might be good stuff for us to chew on, and I'll take it open for questions.
Thank you, Regina. Very interesting, and I'm very interested in your using Watson in your classroom. Let me just ask the participants to put their phones off of mute by pressing star 1 to ask questions. Any questions for Regina?
Okay. Hi, yeah. My name is Paul Courtney, and I'm calling. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay,
thank
good.
You.
So I'm wondering about what these tournaments look like. There was that one slide, and it sounds very interesting. Is it, you know, whether it's sort of a hackathon type of thing, or if a little bit more information would be interesting? And Regina, it's been—it's a fascinating sort of overall picture. I was just at the T Summit earlier this week, so it's really interesting to see a lot of this information coming out and being relevant in the real world in many ways.
Are you still there, Regina?
Well, that'd
Regina?
Be a shame.
Oh, okay.
Is she on mute?
You know, if you might be on mute, press star 1. She didn't leave the meeting. I wonder if her phone got disconnected. Let's just wait for a minute.
Sure.
I was at the T Summit as well. This is Diane.
Yeah.
And I thought it was really good. And Regina was planning to be there, and this would have made a great presentation. If I have a question for Regina, if she comes back, my question would be, you know, do you tell the students, do you tell the millennials how employers view them versus how they, you know, view themselves. I think I have two sons in their 20s, and I was, you know, thinking this chart is the chart that she showed is really right on, in my opinion. But I think my children would be insulted if I showed it to them.
Right. I see Regina is trying to get in. She says she's pressing star one, but no one can hear her.
I don't know. Let me press star five and take everyone off mute. Hang on. Regina, can you hear us? Can you say something? Regina, press star one again and then try to say something. Regina, I can't hear you.
Yeah, she says she's pressing star one. I've muted my own phone before, and then all the star one that I press doesn't make any difference, right?
So you have a mute button on your phone, Regina? Maybe press your mute button and see if that helps? No, I still can't hear you. But if you heard the question.
Hello. My name is Martin Apple. I'd like to make a question while we're still waiting that we could all look at. And the question would be, if you looked at the reading list of those particular publications which she noted, would that be a good qualifier for determining a future employee that you would need to be able to handle the types of things that we've been discussing?
Hi, Martin. I met you at the Tea Summit as well. Thank you for your question. So let me get to the chart with the list of the publications. And Regina, if you're able to respond to any of this in the chat, we can have someone read it out loud. I'm showing the slides, so I can't see the meeting. But this is the list. This is what you're referring to, the upper right,
right.
Chart.
Correct.
Yeah. So your question was, if students are engaged in these publications, would that be a good indicator that they would make a good employee?
And would there be a difference between those who watch television versus those who actually read and think?
That's a good question. Of course, MSNBC and some other things are television.
So Regina says, sure, Martin, these charts are from a Pew Research Center study. I guess if everybody's got the chat window in, they can see what Regina is saying.
Okay.
Well, appreciate you reading it, Paul, just because some people may be on the phone and not.
Oh, right. Yeah. So Pew did a study comparing TV watching versus other news formats.
And
I guess maybe it's up to you to go see the Pew Research Center study.
Yeah, that's fine.
She's typing as fast as she can.
Okay, I will do that. Thank you, Regina. You can mute me if you want.
No, no, no. I'm not going to mute anybody anymore. So it's a shame. I'm so sorry that we're having problems with the audio from Regina. But yeah, she's going to try to call back in. We only have a minute left. She can't hear me say that. But, you know, for those who were at the Peace Summit, did you enjoy the conference? Did you think it was worthwhile? You did.
I thought the problem with the conference essentially boiled down to the fact that there was no defined question being asked that one could aim at. There were sort of a therefore.
Hello?
There you are.
Go ahead.
Hi, it's Regina.
Oh, good.
Yeah,
good.
Hi, Regina.
Okay. So I think if people can hear me, then let's try to see if we can make it work like this, right?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. Okay. So was I able to provide Martin with some information? Okay. Sure, of course. Now, were there, Paul, you had a specific question about the forecasting stuff, right?
Correct. If it was like a hackathon or if you had any more information about that. Sure.
So that's different. I sort of see the two of them of a piece. So I do hackathons. I did a hackathon at NYU, and I sort of put that side by side with the cognitive computing coursework that I do. Strategic forecasting is a little different, but instead of hackathons, what you have are forecasting tournaments. And what a tournament is essentially it's a virtual asynchronous platform-based environment. It's usually browser-based. Whereby a series of questions about geopolitical outcomes in the future are put to a pool of people who are then asked to assign probabilities of those outcomes happening, right? The nature of the tournament is asynchronous so that you can enter forecasts as often as you like. The forecasts are scored on a day-by-day basis so that at the end of the question, in other words, when the question comes to its resolution, either before the stated date or on the stated date, each forecaster receives a score on their accuracy, right? Because this is one of the things that came out of Phil Tetlock's earliest research is that for all the people who do punditry, for all the people who make forecasts, you know, every year at the end of the year you read a newspaper and you've got tons of pundits making forecasts about something that's going to happen next year. Well, Phil Tetlock asked the essential question of, has anybody ever actually gone back to see whether or not those forecasts were accurate or not? And it turns out that nobody ever does do evaluative backtracking. So the idea of a forecasting tournament was devised in order to score people, to track them, right? Is that, you know, you can't just make a prediction that's going to happen and then not be held accountable. So the nature of the forecasting tournament is really designed around the notion of accountability. And so there are training mechanisms that are associated with it. There are tracking mechanisms. We use Brier scoring to track in forecasting tournaments. But these are designed essentially as ways in which we can start developing an archive of information, and also we can start developing pattern detection. So forecasting tournaments represent one type of disruptive technology that when you are putting younger people into these kinds of environments, it forces them, it teaches them to go beyond what they know. They have to learn to be better researchers. They have to understand how to cultivate better news sources. They have to think about news consumption in a different way. They have to think about information in an entirely different way. Cognitive computing also allows for that. It's a different way of doing it when you're dealing with cognitive as you would be doing it within a forecasting tournament. But the end outcomes are effectively the same in that you're trying to utilize these types of disruptive technologies to engender, to get students to think differently about information, because in a 21st century information era environment, they're going to be buffeted on all sides. They can barely handle what they've got now. In 5 years, it's going to be so much more complex, right? So if we don't start thinking now, today, about how to alter how we do pedagogy, to alter how we think about students, right? I mean, I think many teachers look at students as the measuring yardstick that they use for students is themselves, or their peers or their colleagues. You know, those are different generations. So it is very hard for somebody. I mean, I'm a Generation Xer. Many of my colleagues are baby boomers, right? Baby boomers, when they look at millennials, it is very, very hard for them to contextualize how this cohort is thinking because many of
different environments.
Right. You know, many baby boomers barely use email. I mean, I know university professors that barely use email.
Yeah.
Right? These people are not on Twitter, these people are not on Facebook, these people are not for them, the thinking is that, well, I'm past the age where I really need to absorb this, you know, let's leave it for the younger generation. But that is the starting point you must begin with if you are going to be able to cultivate that younger generation. They think completely differently. They are mediated differently, right? I mean, and unfortunately, this is not subject matter that has really risen too far up the fore in the pedagogical world. Most people, when in the pedagogical world today, much of the thinking when you're talking about technology is, how do we use technology to teach better? And much of that thinking is still in that rut of using MOOCs, right? Is using online coursework, massively online coursework, right? Even though the empirical data at this early stage suggests that MOOCs don't work, there's a lot of attrition.
Right. So it's
using
like
that kind of technology.
And new containers kind of thing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
We're going to have to stop.
Yeah.
I hate the conversation. We're running over time. But
okay.
I would like to invite you to a subsequent call, Regina. I would love to go deeper into this whole millennial area because they're so important to our future. And,
yeah.
There's so much to learn from what you have researched. I just want to thank and thank you, Martin and Paul, for your questions. And Regina, thank you very much for being our presenter today. And
my pleasure.
We'll see you.
Thanks
all
for having
next
me.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Thanks. Bye bye.
Thank you. Bye bye.